The subject of the knowledge of the Imams and generally the Prophets and the Ahlul Bayt, peace and blessings be upon them, is a very important and crucial subject, and it's one that has been under scrutiny. Many misconceptions, misinformation, myths have existed.
The knowledge of our beloved Imams, Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam, or if you like, the knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Because we believe, as lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt, according to our aqaid and theology, Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam, they continue with the mission of Rasulullah. So once we are able to establish that with Rasulullah, it makes it easy to establish it with Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam.
عندما يرد في الرواية نحن صنائع الله عن الإمام عليه السلام نحن صنائع الله والخلق صنائعنا إن شئنا شاء الله ولا نشاء إلا أن يشاء الله. وفي رواية عن النبي المصطفى صلى الله عليه وآله فاطمة بضعة مني يرضى الله لرضاها ويغضب لغضبها. وفي الرواية الثالثة السلام على محال معرفة الله. هم عليهم السلام مظهر مشيئة الله تبارك وتعالى.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
هناك علم ضروري للإمام وهناك علم كمالي للإمام.
An understanding of the position and the status that they enjoy in the eyes of God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no way to understand and have a cognizance of their knowledge without first of all having an appreciation of their role, their responsibility, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has indeed chosen them and why He has chosen them.
فإن منصب الإمامة الذي هو عبارة عن القيادة للمجتمع البشري نحو الهداية كما قال تبارك وتعالى وجعلناهم أئمة يهدون بأمرنا وكما قال تبارك وتعالى إنما أنت منذر ولكل قوم هاد. فبما أن مقام الإمامة يعني مقام الهداية للمجتمع البشري فمن الضروري عقلا أن يكون الإمام محيطا بجميع العلوم الدخيلة في تحقيق الهداية.
علم اللدني, as scholars divide knowledge into two. We have علم حصولي and خدوري. حصولي they call obtainable knowledge, where you go and learn from someone. Meaning between yourself and your knowledge, there is someone who is giving you the knowledge. There is intermediary. فالعلم اللدني you get it direct from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course Allah send angel to come and inspire you or to reveal that knowledge to you. Our imams do not have any teacher. Except of course the previous imams and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the question is, their knowledge? Is it limited to worldly matters or only worldly knowledge? Imams alayhi salatu wassalam, as I'm going to quote this riwayah, is a very important riwayah based on our aqidah, that our Imams alayhi salatu wassalam, their knowledge, as Imam Jafar al-Sadiq mentioned, إذا شئنا أن نعلم علمنا. If we want to know, we know it.
Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, in a narration in Al-Kafi, explains what an Imam is there for. He says, there to organize the affairs of the Muslims, to protect the religion. They give dignity, izzul mu'mineen, to the believers. The Imam is there to explain what is lawful and what is not, to establish the law of God, to provide proof, al-hujjah, to use hikmah, wisdom. Importantly, an Imam is purified from sins, mistakes, errors, and shortcomings. He is the best of the people of his time, and no one should be more knowledgeable than him. And based on all these responsibilities and duties that have been bestowed upon them by the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a nutshell, they're God's representatives.
فيجب أن يكون محيطاً بتفسير القرآن وتأويله. يجب أن يكون محيطاً بالتشريع الإلهي بكامل فصوله ودقائقه. وقد ورد عن الإمام أمير المؤمنين علي عليه السلام: والله لو سألتموني عن كل آية آية لأخبرتكم عن وقت نزولها وسبب نزولها وناسخها ومنسوخها وعامها وخاصها ومحكمها ومتشابهها وظاهرها وباطنها. وورد عن الإمام الصادق عليه السلام: وإن عندنا الجامعة. قيل: وما الجامعة؟ قال: كتاب بإملاء رسول الله وخط علي بن أبي طالب، فيه جميع ما يحتاجه الناس من حلال وحرام حتى أرش الخدش إلى يوم القيامة. ويجب أن يحيط الإمام أيضا بالعلوم الإنسانية الدخيلة في الهداية، كعلم النفس، كعلم الاجتماع، كعلم القانون، كعلم الإدارة. كل علم دخيل في تحقيق الهداية الإمام محيط بحقائقه وبواقعه، لا بنظرياته. نحن لا نتحدث عن النظريات التي تقبل الخطأ والصواب، تحدث عن الحقائق. فالإمام محيط بكل العلوم والحقائق الدخيلة في تحقيق الهداية للمجتمع البشري. هذا علم ضروري لا بد منه. وهناك علم كمالي دلت الروايات عليه وإن لم يحكم العقل به، وهذا العلم الكمالي هو ما يرتبط بالولاية التكوينية للإمام عليه السلام. فكما أن الله تبارك وتعالى جعل لسليمان ولاية تكوينية، وسخرنا لسليمان الريح تجري بأمره رخاء حيث أصاب، والشياطين كل بناء وغواص، وآخرين مقرنين في الأصفاد، وقال ربي هب لي ملكا لا ينبغي لأحد من بعدي، فكانت له ولاية تكوينية على الرياح، على الأمطار، على الجن، على الطير، والطير محشورة كل له أواب. وسخر لداود الجبال، سخرنا لداود الجبال يسبحنا بالعشي والإشراق. وكما أن عيسى بن مريم عليه السلام كانت له ولاية تكوينية تحدث عنها القرآن الكريم ورسولا إلى بني إسرائيل أني قد جئتكم بآية من ربكم أني أخلق لكم من الطين كهيئة الطير فأنفخ فيه فيكون طيرا بإذن الله، وأبرئ الأكمه والأبرص وأحيي الموتى بإذن الله، وأنبئكم بما تدخرون في بيوتكم. إذن كما أعطى الله سليمان وداود وعيسى ولاية تكوينية، والمقصود بالولاية التكوينية أن للإمام قدرة على التصرف في قضايا الكون نابعة عن علمه بمفاتيح الكون.
عالم الغيب فلا يظهر على غيبه أحدا إلا من ارتضى من رسول فإنه يسلك من بين يديه ومن خلفه رصدا.
When we take into consideration the important belief in Shia Ithna Ashari theology about the fact that an imam chosen by God the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala possesses special knowledge from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill his duties and responsibilities, the conclusion is that jahlul imam, imam not knowing, somehow constitutes a notion that others will be better than him. And this means that his status will be less, the trust of the people will be less, and then the conclusion is, how can he be from God if there's someone else who is more knowledgeable than them?
كما ورد في الرواية الشريفة إن الإمام يعلم ما كان وما يكون وما هو كائن إلى يوم القيامة، فهو يعلم الأحداث كلها على مستوى واحد. نعم، هذه الأحداث على قسمين، قسم حتمي، قسم فيه البداء. فعلم الإمام ببعض الأحداث علم حتمي، وعلم الإمام ببعض الأحداث علم معلق على البداء. لذلك ورد عن الإمام أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام في رواية صحيحة: لولا آية في كتاب الله لأخبرتكم بما كان وما يكون وما هو كائن إلى يوم القيامة، وتلك الآية قوله عز وجل: يمحو الله ما يشاء ويثبت وعنده أم الكتاب. فهو يعلم بالأحداث كلها على واقعها، والأحداث في واقعها هي تنقسم إلى قسمين: قسم حتمي سيقع، وقسم معلق على مشيئته، يعني على البداء من قبله تبارك وتعالى.
So therefore I believe without a shadow of doubt our imams, they have the knowledge of everything. Yes, they still need more from Allah, because Rasulullah made dua, Rabbi zidni ilma. We are not saying they reach that knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the highest. But Allah provided them and inspired them with that knowledge. So they have the knowledge of worldly matters, and they have the knowledge of religion also. Therefore, you find people like Yahya ibn Aktham, who came to Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, who was regarded as a greatest scientist and who had a lot of questions to ask Imam, thinking that Imam was not going to be able to answer this question. And he found Imam answering all those questions. And those 4,000 students of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, it was not only about religion, about Quran and Hadith. Imam taught so many knowledge.
The principle is the ilm of the Imam is kasbi huduri. It's both with a very important distinction. So, how can we understand this? It's kasbi in that it's obtained from another ma'soom. So, Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, peace and blessings be upon him, famously says, "Allamani Rasulullah alf babin min al-ilm, yuftahu li min kulli bab alf bab." That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught Amir al-Mu'mineen 1,000 doors of knowledge, and from each door opens up another 1,000. So that's the obtaining, the kasbi part, being taught and being given this knowledge from another ma'soom. And the huduri element, the fact that the knowledge is there, is not that it's they are independent. It's from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not that they have all the knowledge. Yes, they have knowledge more than other human beings, who are not the ma'soom, but it's not that the knowledge is from them. The knowledge is from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. He places it in their hearts. And therefore, we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ilmuhu aynu dhatih, that means his knowledge is part of his essence, and he is the one who bestows this knowledge upon these individuals. As the Quran says in Surah Al-Jinn, verse number 26 and 27, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَىٰ غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا إِلَّا مَنْ ارْتَضَىٰ مِنْ رَسُولٍ.
See, Allah brought illah, istisna. Said Allah is the one who knows the knowledge of the unseen. And he does not expose anyone to that knowledge. إِلَّا مَنْ ارْتَضَىٰ مِنْ رَسُولٍ. Except those that is placed with them among his prophets. And no doubt, if there is one prophet, of course Allah pleased with all the prophets, that Allah pleased with him more is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Prophet Muhammad, of course, no doubt is pleased with Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. And that goes down to Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. So our Imams, they knew what was to happen in future. And we have many instances where Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen would speak about what would happen and what will happen in future. And all the events that took place in the lives of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam, they knew about it before it happened. So therefore, Imams of Ahlul Bayt, Allah inspired them with ilm al-ghayb, and they had that ilm al-ghayb, and they were able to tell people, this will be my killer, and this will kill me, and this will affect me.
الإمام علي عليه السلام لما خرج في ليلة التاسع عشر من رمضان نظر إلى السماء وراء النجوم قال والله ما كذبت ولا كذبت هذه الليلة التي وعدت فيها.
So we have narrations in both Sunni and Shia traditions that the commander of the faithful, peace and blessings be upon him, Ali ibn Abi Talib, had an understanding and was aware of the individual who is going to strike him on that particular morning in the mosque of Kufa on the 19th of the month of Ramadan, 40 years after Hijrah. And in fact, when he was walking towards the mosque, he saw him asleep on his stomach and hiding the poison sword underneath, and would say to him that, "What have I done to you that you would like, that you want to kill me?" And of course, other similar sound and strong narrations exist about the other ma'sumin as well.
لا شك في أن الإمام الحسين عليه السلام كان يعلم بمصيره وبتفاصيله وحذافيره. وقد قال في خطبته في مكة المكرمة: سلام الله عليه قال: ألا فمن كان فينا باذلا مهجته موطنا على لقاء الله نفسه فليرحل خط الموت على ولد آدم مخط القلادة على جيد الفتاة وما أولهني إلى أسلافي اشتياق يعقوب إلى يوسف وخير لي يعني الله اختار لي وخير لي مصرع أنا لاقيه هذا المصرع سوف ألقاه حتما وخير لي مصرع أنا لاقيه كأني بأوصالي أيضا يتحدث عن طبيعة المصرع كأني بأوصالي تقطعها عسلان الفلا العسلان هم الذئاب وشبه جيش الأموي بأنهم ذئاب تقطعها عسلان الفلا بين النواويس وكربلا، يصف المنطقة التي سيقع فيها تقطيع جسمه الشريف بالخيول بين النواويس وكربلا، فيملأن مني أكراشا جوفا وأجربة سغبا، لا محيص عن يوم خط بالقلم. فالإمام يعلم بتفاصيل والأحداث، وليس الإمام فقط، حتى زينب العقيلة وحتى العباس بن علي فإنهم ورثوا من أبيهم المرتضى هذا العلم، علم المنايا والبلايا. فالإمام عليه السلام يعلم بتفصيل ذلك كله.
علم المنايا والبلايا is a very important علم which now and then we hear especially when scholars speak about أمير المؤمنين عليه الصلاة والسلام. There are two things here, al-manaya and balaya. And I want to take you a little bit back to the roots of these two terminologies. These are Arabic terminologies. And once we understand the roots, it makes it easy to understand what they represent and what they stand for. The word manaya is jam or maniya in Arabic. And maniya, it means maut, wa mufarakatu dunya. Is to leave the world and to get separated from the world, is to get annihilated and leave the world. So therefore, when we say ilmul manaya, is to have the knowledge of one's end, separating from this world, and the end of one's life, and what's going to happen to a person. And more, to know about the ajal of a person, the destiny. This is what ilm al-manaya is all about. I can tell you about your destiny. I can tell you what's going to happen. I can tell you how the end is going to look like. This was ilm al-manaya. I can tell you when is it going to happen and how is it going to happen. This is ilm al-manaya. And of course, balaya, it explains itself. From the word baliya, bala. That Imams alayhi salatu wasalam, before you go there, balaya is jam or baliya. Baliya means disasters, catastrophes, problems, difficulties in life. Musiba, if you like, mehna. This is what we call baliya. So we have a knowledge like that. People can predict and tell you there will be catastrophe, there will be problems, there will be challenges, there will be disasters. There will be difficulties. And we believe in this knowledge without a shadow of doubt that there are people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed them with this type of knowledge.
من جملة علوم الإمام عليه السلام علم المنايا والبلايا. وهذا لا يختص بالإمام، فإن الإمام علي عليه السلام علم كميل بن زياد وميثم التمار ورشيد الهجري علم المنايا والبلايا، فكانوا عارفين بعلم المنايا والبلايا استقاء من الإمام علي عليه السلام. علم المنايا والبلايا هو عبارة عن حروف مؤلفة من القرآن الكريم ومن آيات القرآن الكريم، إذا وصل الإنسان إليه ونظم هذه الحروف يستطيع من خلالها معرفة ما يبتلي به أي إنسان وما يؤول إليه أجل هذا الإنسان ومصير هذا الإنسان. ولا يعني هذا أن علم المنايا والبلايا ليس خاضعا للبداء، هو أيضا على قسمين، فيه حتمي وفيه بداء. فالإمام المعصوم من جملة علومه الشريفة علم المنايا والبلايا وعلم الجفر وعلم الرمل، هناك عدة علوم، وعلم الطلسمات. كل هذه العلوم الغريبة لا بنظرياتها الزائفة، بحقائقها موجودة لدى الإمام عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف.
But here there's a question people ask. Does this contradict a verse in the Quran and the general idea in the Quran that informs us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that we don't know when we're going to die? وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتٍ. The soul does not know which of the places of the land they'll be when they meet their Lord and leave this particular existence. How can we reconcile with this and the discussion surrounding the knowledge of the Imam? Well, simply, this verse is in reference to the idea that the human beings, independently, they don't know. So, without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling them, they would not know. And the proof for this is, didn't the Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, tell people that in the khutbah of Hajjatul Wada' in the last few months before he left this world, he would say to them, innani awshaku an ud'a fa ujib. You know, I'm just about to be called by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that the Sahaba around him, they said, we knew that this was the final year of the Prophet because, for example, we found him to, his i'tikaf increased, his visitation to the cemeteries increased, and there were a few other signs that they recognized about the Holy Prophet, and he had himself told them, and they kind of had that understanding. So the knowledge and the recognition that the Prophet knew is certainly there. And this ayah can be understood to mean that without Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala saying and informing certain individuals, of course they do not know. But by and large, human beings do not have this knowledge. But there is no reason why the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala would not disclose this to his chosen servants.
If Imams know the future events, the question is, can they go against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We have established that Imams know the future events. Imams will never go against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I give an example. When we go to Quran, Allah speaks about Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Ibrahim saw in his dream slaughtering his son. Inni ara fil manami anni athbahuka fanzur madha tara. When Ibrahim woke up, he was to follow the amr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if it was heavy for him to slaughter the son, but he cannot go against the command of Allah azza wa jal.
There's two things to understand. First of all, these holy individuals are the most tested by the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. They go through the most severest of examinations and trials. In order for others not to say, well, you know, it's all well and good for a prophet or an imam to live a life which does not have many bala or imtihanat, they should be the role models. They went through a lot of suffering. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has narrated to have said, ma udhiya nabiyyun mithla ma udhiit. There's no prophet who has gone through hardship the way I have. Therefore, yes, they recognize this, but also at the same time, they understand that it's part of the system of calamities, trials, and examinations. Number one. Number two, the knowledge that has been given to them, it is not utilized for their own benefit. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He's alamul ghaib. He knows about any of us before even creating us. And he recognizes, he knows that whether this knowledge will be misused or not. So when it's given to them, it's not for their own personal benefits. And that's why we find evidence after evidence of the imma alayhim as-salam, when they're presented with cases, court cases and so on, they want to see proof. They demand to see evidence. Well, if you argue, they have the knowledge, so they can immediately rule. But the deduction is that they go with the apparent, of vahir, what is being given. For the people say, well, you know what? You are passing a judgment on this individual. You know, surely this judgment should be based on evidence, despite the fact that you have this knowledge.
لا يمكن للإمام أن يفعل ما يخالف مشيئة الله. لأن الإمام نفسه هو مظهر لمشيئة الله. الإمام مظهر ومجلى لمشيئة الله وإرادته، فكل التصرفات الصادرة عنه هي حكاية لمشيئة الله وإرادته، فكيف يصدر عن الإمام ما ينافي قدرا حتميا أو قضاء حتميا لله تبارك وتعالى، والحال بأن الإمام هو مظهر مشيئته تبارك وتعالى.
If there is this belief that the prophets and the imams have special knowledge from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala that others do not have, the question is, of course, do they know when the day of judgment will occur? And did they have this knowledge or not? And somebody asked this question to Imam Ali alayhi salam. This hadith is found in Basair al-Darajat, page 131. Asbag ibn Nubata says, I heard Amir al-Mu'mineen say that as far as this knowledge is concerned, the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives and we are talking about, is divided into two. One he keeps for himself, and one element, dimension, he gives to his chosen servants. And the one that he keeps for himself is the knowledge of the time and the occurrence of when the occurrence of the day of judgment will be, the ilmu sa'a, because in Surah Luqman, verse 34, it is mentioned, Inna Allaha indahu ilmu sa'a. Yes, so it is a knowledge that belongs to, reserved for God. قُلْ عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ رَبِّي. So the prophets and the imams, according to the Quran and the narrations from them, do not know when the day of judgment will happen. Even when it comes to the discussion surrounding the time of the reappearance of Imam Sahib al-Asr wa Zaman al-Mahdi al-Muntazar ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-Sharif, there is strong indication, and many of our scholars have presented evidence to show that the Imam himself does not know when that will happen. Therefore, this knowledge is only for the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, is reserved for him jalla wa ala.
ويقول الذين كفروا لست مرسلا قل كفى بالله شهيدا بيني وبينكم ومن عنده علم الكتاب.
قال من يأتيني بعرشها، سليمان يخاطب حاشيته، من يأتيني بعرشها أي عرش بلقيس قبل أن يأتوني مسلمين، من الذي يقدر منكم على أن يقتلع عرش بلقيس الذي هو عرش من الذهب والفضة والجواهر ومثبت بالبناء في اليمن، من يأتيني بعرشها من اليمن إلى بيت المقدس قبل أن يأتوني مسلمين؟ قال عفريت من الجن أنا آتيك به قبل أن تقوم من مقامك، يعني أن الجن له ولاية تكوينية، يستطيع الجن أن ينقل بناء من مكان إلى مكان، إذن الجن له ولاية تكوينية. قال عفريت من الجن أنا آتيك به قبل أن تقوم من مقامك. قال الذي عنده علم من الكتاب وهو آصف بن برخية أنا آتيك به قبل أن يرتد إليك طرفك، قبل أن تغمض عينك هكذا أنا آتيك به. ما هو المراد بالكتاب هنا؟ كتاب الوجود. هذا الوجود له علم، يعني له مفاتيح، من اطلع على الوجود وعلى أسراره استطاع أن يتصرف في هذا الوجود. الجن اطلعوا على بعض مفاتيح الكون لذلك يستطيعون التصرف. آصف بن مرخية اطلع على مقدار من هذه المفاتيح فاستطاع أن يأتي بعرش بلقيس خلال لحظة واحدة من اليمن إلى بيت المقدس. هذا عرف علما من الكتاب، فكيف بمن عرف علم الكتاب كله؟ ولذلك قالت الآية المباركة قل كفى بالله شهيدا بيني وبينكم ومن عنده علم الكتاب، ألا وهو الإمام أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام، بحسب ما ورد في الروايات الشريفة أن عنده علم الكتاب، علم الكتاب التشريعي وهو القرآن، وعلم الكتاب التكويني وهو الوجود. فإذا أمسك الإمام بمفاتيح الوجود علما استطاع قدرة أن يتصرف في هذا الكون، وهذا هو معنى الولاية التكوينية. فكيف لا نستبعد الولاية التكوينية على الجن وهم شياطين ونقول لهم ولاية تكوينية ونستبعده في حق الإمام المعصوم. إن الإمام عليه السلام لديه عدة أبواب لعلمه. الباب الأول أن الملائكة تتحدث مع الإمام المعصوم، ولا غرابة في ذلك. الملائكة تحدثت مع مريم وهي ليست نبيا ولا إماما، وإذ قالت الملائكة يا مريم إن الله اصطفاك وطهرك واصطفاك على نساء العالمين، وإذ قالت الملائكة يا مريم إن الله يبشرك بكلمة من اسمه المسيح عيسى بن مريم. فإذا تحدثت الملائكة مع مريم فأي مانع من أن تتحدث الملائكة مع السيدة الزهراء عليه السلام أو مع الأئمة المعصومين عليهم السلام.
No doubt, we as lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt in our Aqidah, Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam, are inspired by Allah. And also angels come to Ahlul Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam. Yani they receive knowledge from angels alayhim salatu wassalam.
We have, of course, narrations that point to the sources of the knowledge of the Imam. For example, we have in Al-Kafi the narration from Isa ibn Hamza al-Thaqafi, which says, قلت لأبي عبد الله الصادق, I said to Imam al-Sadiq عليه السلام, we ask you questions sometimes, so you give us an answer very quickly. And sometimes you wait, then you answer us. Why? Imam responds in this way. He says, إِنَّهُ نَعَمْ ينقر وينكت في آذاننا وقلوبنا. Yes, sometimes the knowledge is somehow driven into our ears and in our hearts. If it is given to us or if it is placed there at that moment, then we answer. If not, we wait. This gives us an idea that this is one way in which they obtain this knowledge. So when we look at the classification, they say there is a kitab known as Kitab al-Jami'ah. This is a book which is the imla of the Holy Prophet, which means the Prophet read it or mentioned it and Amir al-Mu'mineen wrote it. Peace be upon him.
والباب الثالث هو أن لديهم علما لدنيا كما قال القرآن عن الخضر عليه السلام. فوجد فيها عبدا من عبادنا صالحا ثم قال وآتيناه من لدنا علما أي يسمى علم لدني.
So therefore their source of knowledge is not like the source of knowledge of any other person, like the source of knowledge of any other companion. It is the same source of knowledge of Rasulullah which was given to Ahlul Bayt عليهم الصلاة والسلام.
عندما نقرأ في الزيارة السلام عليك يا وارث آدم صفوة الله، وارث نوح النبي الله، وارث إبراهيم خليل الله، وارث موسى كليم الله، وارث عيسى روح الله، وارث محمد حبيب الله، وارث أمير المؤمنين علي ولي الله. هذه كتب، جميع كتب الأنبياء تناقلت من نبي إلى نبي إلى إمام إلى الأئمة الطاهرين، فبيدهم مواريث الأنبياء، كتب الأنبياء بأيديهم. وأيضا الكتب التي كتبها الإمام أمير المؤمنين وصلت للأئمة الطاهرين صلوات الله وسلامه عليهم أجمعين. والباب الرابع هو الاكتساب. قال علي عليه السلام علمني رسول الله 1000 باب من العلم يفتح لي من كل باب 1000 باب.
If we somehow come to the understanding that these individuals, their existence is to show us the path to salvation, righteousness, virtue, perfection, to teach us how to get to paradise, then by suggesting that all that they have, as far as their knowledge is concerned, is to do with what is halal and haram or restricted to Sharia is certainly limiting them. And what the deduction would be that some people who have knowledge that would benefit human beings in other spheres may be in a higher position than them. And we have discussed and we have said in previous moments that we believe that these individuals must be the best of the people of their time. Therefore, their objective to guide and improve the lives of people is not only restricted to the knowledge of the Sharia. They need to have and they do have the knowledge of other disciplines. And we have examples of this. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam taught people like Jabir ibn Hayyan chemistry. Imam Sadiq's university was multi-faceted in many aspects. It was the astronomy, there was the chemistry, there was the physics, and the other medicine, and so on. So certainly the Imam's alayhi salam's knowledge is not restricted there, but they were not given the opportunity, unfortunately, by the people, not allowed to lead and present the people with this knowledge. Remember, if you study the biographies of the Imams, peace be upon them, by and large, it was persecution, oppression, they had to live in fear, imprisonment, and so on. So the knowledge is there, but they, when they were given this opportunity, relatively, like Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, he would give to what people would be able to withstand and understand. And that's why Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, would say to people, saluni qabla an tafqiduni. Ask me before you lose me. Didn't say, ask me about only religion, religious matters. Ask me, just present your questions before you lose me. And it's general. It's that knowledge that they have from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why we believe when the Imam alayhi salam, the 12th Holy Imam, may Allah hasten his reappearance, when he reappears and establishes this just government, the knowledge that he would be presenting to the people, it would be so outstanding that it would impact their lives in all aspects. It would really raise the standard in terms of their well-being and their happiness and the way they live because of the knowledge that the Imam alayhi salam would have. And we have examples and evidence from the rawayat that people, the Imams would say, if they allowed us, we would present them knowledge that would bring them the rizq from the sama, from the heavens, you know, on how they would be able to live a better life. But unfortunately, the oppression, the injustice, the egoistic, worldly tendencies of people somehow overcame these individuals and did not utilize the great personalities of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam.
لا يمكن لأي إمام أن يعلم علما حتى يأخذه من علي وهذا هو معنى أنا مدينة العلم وعلي بابها فمن أراد المدينة فليأتها من بابها أي أن كل علم يحصل عليه أي إمام معصوم حتى وإن لم ير عليا حتى وإن لم يعاصر عليا كالإمام الباقر والصادق والكاظم ومن بعده لا يمكن لأي علم أن يصل إلى قلبه حتى يكون لهذا الإمام تواصل روحي مع روح الإمام أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام وهو في عالم البرزخ ليأخذ العلم منه وهذا معنى أن عليا باب مدينة العلم وهذا معنى ما ورد عن الإمام الصادق عليه السلام كلنا في الفضل سواء وعلي له شأن